half hour series, and this is going to be black hole physics. Just want to share on a lighter note that, you know, we have some difficulty about selecting experts for black hole physics. Like to tell Surat that, you know, he faced a very stiff competition from, if you have heard Alia Bhatt pontificating on black hole physics. So we were not quite sure, you know, who would be another fit, but since the stakes were into the future of Indian high energy physics, we had to stick with Surat, and I'm sure you're all glad that we stuck to Surat. We are very glad that Surat had such an invitation, you know, to come over and talk about careful information and the backward physics. And Surat is a very well-known person in the physics of black hole, not just in India, but world over. At a young age, he has really done work which has, you know, sought attention of the world community. He did his graduation from Delhi St. Stephen's College and his PhD from Harvard. And he was also an adjunct faculty, and I think he was still an adjunct faculty in HRI. And is currently a faculty with the ICTS at Bangalore. Thanks, sir, for accepting my invitation and coming over to this place far from anywhere. Along with Surat, we have also Sayantini Bhattacharya from IIT Kanpur. Sayantini did her PhD with Shiraz at JFR, and you are also at HRI. Yeah, briefly at HRI for a postdoctoral work, and she is currently an assistant professor at physics department IIT Kanpur. I'm also pleased to invite Dr. Amin Nizami. Yeah, he did his PhD from University of Cambridge University, and is currently working at ICTS Bangalore. So we have a very good team of, you know, black hole physicists, and I'm sure you will enjoy the lectures. Thanks so much. Over. Yeah, just one line, you know, and this is important, I think. I think Surat will know about, you know, his work on black hole physics through his lectures, but what maybe lesser known is that, you know, we as scientists are just way too engrossed in our academia, very often are unmindful of what is happening around us, and our so-called social responsibility can at best be, you know, encapsulated in our occasional maybe post on social media. But that's not what Surat is. Surat is actually a very well-known activist in the area of... there's a big deal about this nuclear deal, and he has written maybe at least one dozen articles, maybe more. and the beauty of this article is that, you know, when a physicist takes up any social cause, there is an element of objectivity and clarity about how he goes about his job. And those articles are a beautiful example of not just how, you know, big projects which impact all of us, how they should actually go about, how they should be researched. So he has done amazing analysis about the economics as well as beautiful political analysis also occasionally have found in the, some of the articles that he has done. And I could connect whatever he wrote in those articles because when I read this book on Manmohan Singh, the accidental prime minister, where there is a big deal about the nuclear deal that, you know, he really went out of his way to make sure that it happens. And it connects nicely with whatever he has written. So I strongly encourage you to, you know, take a look at his articles on whether the nuclear power is actually the way to go, or, you know, there are lots of ifs and buts that need to be addressed before we go full throttle over it. Yeah, over to the world for that. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the organizers for, you know, organizing this lovely school, and also for inviting me to lecture here. This is my first time in Pilani, but I've had it's all been very nice, and I really like the campus and the way the school is working, and I hope these lectures will go as well, and that you will enjoy them also. I have to say, I hope at the end of these lectures to get all of you to the level of Alia Bhatt, which I must say is actually something I also sometimes use to, you know, tell people when they ask me what I'm working on, and I say, you know, go see the Alia Bhatt, AIB video, and that explains it very well. And so it's true that at the end of that, she gives a very clear explanation of the information paradox and some resolution. So hopefully at the end of it, we will all be at that very elevated level. So, as I said already, the object of this is basically to try and understand the modern information paradox. So what I'm going to try and do in these lectures is start from classical black holes and try and go on to describing the modern information paradox. So, as you may know, this is a subject which has seen a lot of recent activity in the quantum gravity community. And so that's where I'd like to take you. And some of the topics I'll talk about are, in fact, more than half the course is not textbook stuff, and it's stuff which is related to more recent research material. But yet, I think that a lot of it is accessible and is not too hard. And so hopefully these lectures will be a useful resource. But that being said, please feel free to stop me and interrupt me and ask me whatever questions you like. I have to admit that this is also my first CERC school in any capacity, and therefore it would really help me if you were to ask me questions and help me along the way. So there's one more resource I wanted to point out to you. As it happens, this is the centennial year of general relativity. It's been 100 years since the start of general relativity. And the American Physical Society has put together a collection of seminal papers. They're called the GR Centennial Papers. So if you search, if you do a Google search for GR Centennial Collection, on EPS, which is the publishers of the Physical Review, then you will find this collection of papers. It's a collection of papers that goes all the way back, I think, to 20 or 30 or something. And in fact, as it happens, many of the things that we'll talk about were, published in the Physical Review, which was the dominant journal for many years. And so a lot of these papers are historic papers, and they're still good papers to read. And so I'll refer to them as we go along. But this is a useful resource, for all of you to read, because it's useful to look at the original literature sometimes and see what is it that people were thinking about when they did this. A lot of what was in those papers is now textbook material, but even then it's very useful to go and look back at those papers. So I don't have the exact hyperlink right now, but if you do a search for this, you will find it very easily. And I strongly encourage all of you to read these papers as we go along. So let me give you a rough overview of what I'm going to say. It's a rough overview because I don't know if I'll manage, how well I'll manage to stick to the schedule. But roughly, the way I'd like to do this is I'd like to start by talking about which is today. Can you see at the back? So I want to start by talking about Schwarzschild black holes. And so this is in some sense, a warm-up lecture just to try and get all of us on the same page on this simplest black hole solution, and which in some sense will play a very key role in everything. So it's very important that all of us are on the same page here. And then I want to talk about, I want to talk about other classical black hole solutions. And this includes, black holes formed from collapse, and also, the Reissner-Nordström black hole. This is Reissner-Nordström RN and the Kerr-Newman black hole. In lecture 3, I want to talk about black hole thermodynamics. So this is in some sense part 1 of this mini course, which is classical black holes and their properties. And lecture 4 to 9 will be, 4 to 9 will be, quantum, and I'll tell you more about these lectures as we go along. But roughly, this is the part for the first three lectures, which is the first part before the break day. And I want to talk about classical black hole solutions. Okay. So as I said, today I want to start by talking about the Schwarzschild black hole solution. And in fact, perhaps many of you have seen the black hole solution, the Schwarzschild black hole solution, maybe all of you. So what I want to do today, though, is try and derive this solution for you and show you how it's a solution which is rather unique if you make some very simple assumptions. And then we'll discuss some other properties of these solutions. Just to get a brief sense of where we are, how many of you have seen the Schwarzschild solution before? Is that all of you? Or? Okay, so large fraction of you have seen the Schwarzschild solution before. Okay, so that's good. So for those of you, it'll be something of a review, and maybe there'll be some new things today. as I said, in any case, you know, feel free to stop me if I'm saying things that you're not familiar with. Okay, so today, you know, what we want to do is we want to explore the properties of black holes, which are spherically symmetric. So, you know, we live in a four-dimensional world, and simple, you know, Einstein's equations are difficult equations, and they're hard to solve. And so it's often useful to make assumptions about symmetry to help us solve them. And one assumption that's often made, which actually turns out, as we will see, to capture almost all of the essential features that we need for our purposes, is the assumption of spherical symmetry. So that reduces the problem down from some very complicated, you know, nonlinear and some partial differential equations to things that are ordinary differential equations, as I'll show you now. We want to start with the metric ansatz. You can see this part as well. There isn't a glare at the back. So I want to assume that the universe is spherically symmetric. Okay. And the way to assume that is to assume that the metric has some form. So what I've done here, as I said, we live in a four-dimensional world in which there's some radial direction and there's some time direction. Okay, so far I haven't said anything about what the physical meaning of this time is. This time may or may not be the time we are seeing. But all I've said is there are four directions which I've divided into one time-like direction, which is this E. You know, you could put a minus sign here, but A0 can be negative, so I'm not putting a minus sign here. This is the state. There could be cross terms between T and R. And the assumption I've made here is that there's this sphere in the metric. So there's this term which looks like d omega squared, but d omega squared has this, you know, has the form of the line element. So this is the central assumption I've made, and I haven't made any other assumption. And now I'd like to show you that starting with this very weak assumption, which is just an assumption that there's a sphere in the metric, we can actually show that the unique solution that has these properties is the Schwarzschild solution. Okay. So the first thing to do actually is to recognize that, as you know, because we didn't say anything about what these T and R coordinates were, you know, we can make a lot of coordinate redefinitions because we have a lot of freedom. So, you know, if somebody is has written down this metric using one set of T and R coordinates, somebody else can use a different set of T and R coordinates and can write down a metric that's equally good. So coordinate choices are totally convention dependent you know, they don't have any invariant physical meaning. So in particular, you know, it's very convenient to choose d0 equal to r squared. Okay. So it's always, you know, it's always possible to make some choice so that you choose this d0 function to be r squared. So if someone had some choice of r, I could just take whatever d0 function they have and define a new r, okay, so that d0 was equal to r squared. In fact, just to make this clear, let me put some zeros. Okay, so this is my r0. And now I define d0 equal to r squared. All of these were functions, by the way, of t0 and r0. So, you know, a0 function of t0 and r0. t0 is a function of t0 and r0. t0 is a function of t0 and r0. These t0 and r0 are some coordinates, but now I define the new r coordinate, which is related to r0 and t0 through this. Okay, so it's a function which is, I've made a coordinate change when I've defined a new r coordinate, which is given by t0. Okay, so this here. So if I do that, then my metric gets the following form. I get an r squared here. I get some other functions. Let me call them c1. Okay. So these are new functions that I get by making a change to these new set of coordinates. And this becomes r. Okay, so it's a new coordinate. So is it clear how, if I make this redefinition, I can get rid of the d0 term and I can go to something of this form? Is this clear so far? Or not clear? If you make a change of coordinates, and the metric has a certain, you know, metric transforms like a rank 2 tensor, and so you can do this transformation of the metric. By construction, since I said the coefficient of the sphere equal to r squared, in the new metric I'll get this. The t and r terms will transform in some complicated way. You see, because I've defined the new r coordinate as a function of the old r coordinate and as a function of t. So the t and r terms will transform in some way, but I didn't tell you anything about the a, b, and c terms. And so, you know, I will have, you know, sum A1, B1 and C1, then you can easily calculate how A1, B1 and C1 are related to A0, B0 and C0. But you know, we are not interested in that because we didn't say anything about A0, B0 and C0 to start. Okay, good. So now, I've already redefined my R coordinate, but I still have some T freedom left. I still have freedom to define a new T coordinate. So I can define a new T coordinate in such a way as to get rid of this cross term. It is this cross term B. And that's actually pretty easy to see. So remember that, you know, the way metrics transform how metrics transform. So now I want to go to a new T coordinate, okay, so that GRT is 0. So I want to show you that you can make a change to a coordinate system so that this cross term, which is B1, actually vanishes in this new coordinate system. But it's okay. So it's not hard, you know, if you plug things into that formula, you'll find that, you know, GRT and you know you can work out what these partial derivatives are. So for example, you know it's easy to see that if you just write you can work out what these partial derivatives are. Okay? So you can work out, for example, the dt0. Like dt constant r is just, you know, what I'm saying up here is, you know, I'm just trying to make a change to a new coordinate system. So I had some old coordinates which were t0 and r, and I'm trying to make a change to a new coordinate system to get rid of the cross term. Okay, so this is my new coordinate t, which is a function of t0 and r. Okay, and now, you know, you get some partial derivatives when you make this metric transformation. I'm just trying to compute what these partial derivatives are. In taking these partial derivatives, you have to be clear, you have to be careful about what is a function of what, okay, and what you're keeping constant. So I'm specifying that here. So this is, you know, the derivative of dt with dr while keeping t0 constant. So if you do that, you know, you can work out what all these partial derivatives are. You know, it comes from this formula. But in the end, you can check that you know, what you need is that a1 into dt by dr by dt by dt is 0. Okay, this is equal to b1. So if you want this grt to vanish, okay, you find some relation between you know, these coefficients, a1, b1, t and t0. The key point is actually not the details of these, but the following fact. You know, if I give you, you know, an initial, you see, think of the space, think of the t space. By the way, no, not getting lost in the algebra, if you think of the TR space, so here's the T0, here's your R, and what I want to do is I want to define some new coordinate in such a way so as to make, you know, one of these metric functions vanish, one of these coefficients vanish. So you find some relationship between the derivative of, you know, t with respect to t0 and t with respect to r, which is given as a function of these original coefficients t1 and b1 that you have. And the key point is that, you know, if you give me, you know, this is an ordinary differential, it's a partial differential equation, but if you give me some initial conditions, if you give me some t at this value of r, so I can't draw in three dimensions, but let's say you give me, you know, some value of t on this initial slice, then I can use the differential equations that I have to evolve this upwards, okay, so as to get T everywhere on this plane. So the key point is that the kind of equation that you get here so relates the derivative of this new coordinate that you want T with respect to T0, okay, with the derivative of this coordinate with respect to R. And that's an equation that you can integrate given initial conditions. And therefore you can find some solution to it. The details of the solution that you find will depend on, you know, what these coefficients A1 and B1 and so on were initially. But the key point is that, you know, this is something that you can integrate. And therefore when you do this integral, you know, you can use this, you can use this differential equation to go up, you know, to integrate it slice by slice. Are all of you familiar with how, you know, you integrate these partial differential equations? So it's some solution that you can integrate. And if you do this, the key point is that you get rid of, you know, these cross terms. And so you end up with a metric which now has a very simple form, which has a form which is, which has a form which I'll write as ds squared is equal to now, you know, sum a of r e de squared plus b of r e dr squared plus r squared d omega. So what I've shown you so far is that just by using spherical symmetry, you know, you can already reduce the metric to this form by using spherical symmetry and a convenient choice of coordinates, the RT coordinates. You can start with a metric that was more complicated and reduce things to this form. Okay? Now at this point, you know, we have done all that we can just by making coordinate choices, and now we have to try and input you know, the equations of motion. So I'm going to do that now and try and find solutions to these equations. Okay. You know, we are interested in finding solutions to the equations of motion, and the Schwarzschild black hole, even though it's a black hole, has a property that it's actually a solution to the vacuum Einstein equations. So there isn't actually any, you know, there is some mass of the black hole, but all that mass is sitting somewhere at the central singularity. If you look at most of space, the Schwarzschild black hole is a solution which has the property of being a vacuum solution. And so the solution that we want to find is also a vacuum solution. So in the vacuum, by the way, the Einstein equations become very simple. You know what the Einstein equations in the vacuum are? That's it. It is dμ equals 0, but there's actually a simpler form, which is, you know, because dμ is 0, you can actually show that you can write these equations as rμ is 0. Okay. So you can write these equations as rμ is 0. Maybe in the tutorials we can check whether this is the case. It's easy to check if you start with dμ equals 0, that you find that rμ has to be 0. Okay? You need to, you know, compute these rμ coefficients. So I think one thing which we will do in the tutorials is try and show you how you can compute these rμ coefficients given these coefficient functions A and B. In general, the formulas that lead to the computation of these Ricci tensor look very formidable. But one of the things that's nice about computers is that they let you do these analytic computations very easily. And there are these mathematical packages that let you do these computations, and that basically are as simple as, you know, entering this metric and then asking you to do these, you know, just compute the Ricci tensor and it will just give it to you. And there are these Mathematica packages and also other packages. So I think one of the things you want to do in the tutorials is introduce you to these packages. So hopefully all of you have at least some familiarity with trying to use these things. But in any case, once you do this computation, you find the following. I won't write down all the elements, but you find the following. You find that RTT is given by RRR into A by B minus B del A by del R. And then you find that R E R is D B by D T by R E, and R theta theta is 1 minus 1 by Z minus R del A by del R. Okay, and R55. Okay, so hopefully by the end of this tutorial today, all of you will be able to derive these expressions. But anyway, this is what this is. And these are the non-zero components of the Ricci tensor. Okay. Now, the thing is that, you see, we want all these components to be zero. So in particular, we want RTT to be zero, and we want RRR to be zero. That means that their difference must also be zero. So in particular, it tells you that this term must be zero. Tells you that this term must be zero. And that tells you that A, this term is d by dr of AB, and therefore tells you that AB can only be a function of T. So in particular, it tells you AB can only be a function of T. Second, from here, by setting RTR equal to 0, you see that dB by dt has to be 0. So B can only be a function of R. So you see that RTR equal to 0, this implies B is some function of R. And this, this term implies that AB is some function of T. Okay. For now, I'm going to set AB equal to minus 1. And in the tutorials, you should check why that's justified, why I don't use a more general form of AB is a function of T. But for now, let me just set AB equal to minus 1. And show you a solution. So it's not hard, So the thing is that there are two things to do. So we already have got a lot of information from these things. We already see that B is a function only of f of r, and we see that AB is a function only of t. Okay? But now notice that the equation that you need to solve, which is this one, is basically now only an ordinary differential equation in R. What you need to solve is that this guy is zero, but you already know, you already know that AB is a constant, so you can write A as 1 over B, effectively, into something else that doesn't depend on R, and therefore you see that the equation that you have to solve, which is the R theta theta equation, it's an ordinary differential equation in R. So you have to solve and it's an ordinary differential equation in one independent variable. So it has one dependent variable, which is R. It has only one independent variable because you already fixed the product of AB to be something that doesn't depend on R. So you get one equation, which is one equation in B and R, and that equation is easy to solve, which I will again leave for the tutorials. And you find that the solution that you get is that A is minus 1 minus YZM by R. And this is something which I would like all of you to check. Yeah.
Do we get any constraints from RRR equals to 0?
Yeah, good. So that's one more thing to check. You should check that this solution will also solve that. So it's true. You need to check very carefully that haven't you written what RTT and RRR are? And so what this equation does is it tells you this term is 0. The difference of RTT and RRR is 0. It tells you that this is 0, this is 0, tells you R55 is 0. It doesn't tell you whether RTT is 0. And you should check that using this also tells you RTT is 0. The expression for RTT is more complicated, but you can check that it does. Once you have all of the expressions, you can check that. Okay. Are there any other questions about this? Okay. Am I going too fast, or is there something that all of you have seen? Why are you getting this? There's no reason for you to get this. It just so happens. I've just, this is the statement that I've just made an observation. When you compute RTT and RRR, it so happens that the answers you get are related in this way. There's no a priori reason for this. That's correct. So here what I did was I set a particular linear combination of RTT and RRR to 0. That's enough to solve the equations. You need to check, of course, that RTT itself is 0. So this is just an observation I'm making about the solution. Any other questions about this? Okay. Very good. Okay.
So, maybe instead of setting it to be GD, you set it to be some function of just minus 1.
Yeah.
So if I don't do that, A will have some factor of T.
Correct. You should check. You should check what happens if you don't do that. So by the way, there's a number of exercises which I'm leaving to you if you don't. Here's one. What happens if you try and use this? Basically, all the questions that you're asking now are all exercises to do in the tutorials. You know, what happens if you said AB is a function of T? You know, is it true that the RTT equation is satisfied? Okay, so those were the two main things, and the fact that you can get that solution. So all of these are they're very simple, and if you think about it for a few minutes, I'm sure you'll see the answer. But I'd like you to think about it for a few minutes rather than I giving you the answer. Okay, very good. Okay, so now the next thing is, you know, what is the physical significance of this parameter m that we have here? So there's some parameter I wrote down. This parameter comes out as an integration constant. So it's some integration constant. And the question is, what does this parameter mean? Okay. So to see the significance of this parameter, it's actually very useful to look at the geodesic equation. You see, this parameter, as you might have guessed, is going to turn out to look like the mass. But in fact, the question in general relativity is always, you know, how do you define the mass of some object? And you know, we have some non-relativistic or some Newtonian notion of what mass is. But in general, in the relativistic context, just what it means to have a certain mass is something that's something that, you know, you can generalize a non-relativistic definition in various ways. And one very convenient way to define mass is basically to define mass by the effect that a metric has on objects moving about at infinity. You know, in the end, when we determine the mass of the sun, we don't determine the mass of the sun by actually, you know, going into the sun and trying to, you know, determine what the density and various constituents are. What we do is we look at the effect that the metric or the presence of the sun as a central body has in planetary orbit, and then we try and determine the mass of the sun from that. So whenever we determine the mass of something, you know, we actually, the gravitational mass of something, we determine it basically by looking at what kind of effect it has in distant trajectories. So one definition of the mass, you know, almost a definition of the mass, is basically saying, you know, if you have some object in the center, then to define the total mass of the system, you go off to spatial infinity, go off to some very far away radial, you know, direction, and look at the behavior of geodesics in that, you know, in that region, in this weak field region, and from that you read off the mass. So the mass is always defined in general relativity in terms of some boundary data, in terms of, you know, how things behave, you know, at very far away spatial infinity, and there we know, you know, because we are demanding that the world is asymptotically flat, but the subleading behavior of the metric or the subleading behavior of various terms, you know, is something that gives you the mass. So I'll show you how that's done in this situation. You know, what you need to do is look at the behavior of the geodesic equation very far away. So all of you know the geodesic equation, and the geodesic equation is this. And now the claim is that, you know, you go off to some very distant region, where both of these terms, you know, look like one. Because you see, if you're at r very large, as r goes to infinity, you see that these terms become increasingly insignificant, and this looks like minus one, and this looks like one. And then if you write down the geodesic equation and work out the connection coefficients, you'll find that the geodesic equation looks like this. And this is basically, you know, Newton's force law. Now it's telling you that the geodesic equation that you have looks like this. And this is the attraction of a central force. So if you have some body which is very far away, which is moving in this metric, then it tends to accelerate as if it was being accelerated, you know, with some object of this kind. And this lets you, you know, identify m as just g into the mass. It lets you identify this parameter m that appeared in the solution as g into the mass. And this is, you know, it's almost, it comes by looking at the behavior of geodesics far away, and this is the way mass in general is defined in theories of generalism. Okay, good. So let me just summarize what we did. You know, what I summarized, just to summarize, The first exercise, a simple exercise here. Well, we have found that the metric is this. All of these I'm putting t equal to 1, t applied equal to 1. We should restore these units to the data. Okay, so this is what we found, and it's actually a rather remarkable, you know, it's a rather, in some sense, if you step back, it's something we've got a lot out of putting in very little. You know, all we put in at the beginning, the only thing that we put in at the beginning was that we had a metric ansatz which had this factor, which had a d omega square factor. So we started with a very general metric ansatz which had some d omega square factor, and starting with that very general metric ansatz and assuming nothing else, not even assuming that things had to be static or things had to be, you know, we didn't assume any such thing, we just assumed that things had to be aesthetically symmetric, and we were able to derive, you know, putting this in and the vacuum Einstein equations in, the full form of the metric, and identified as, you know, as the metric of some body with a mass m. And what we've done actually in a sense is prove what's called Birkhoff's theorem. Okay. So Birkhoff's theorem is basically what we've done right now, is the statement that if you want to look at spherically symmetric solutions of the vacuum Einstein equations, then they're unique. So spherically symmetric, I mean this is the unique spherically symmetric solution. So it's a very powerful theorem, and it tells you that, you know, this is the unique spherically symmetric solution that you have to deal with.
Sir,
yeah.
If small r is a function of t, still this...
If small r is no, small r, what do you mean? Small r is not a function of t.
Now, if it is a function of t, then still it will hold?
Sorry, what does it mean for small r is a coordinate. You want small m to be a function of t, or small r to be a function? Small r can't be a function of t, it's an independent coordinate. What does it mean for small, I mean, two coordinates can't be, you have x and y, and they're just two coordinates that specify the space time, and there's no sense in which, you know.
So the mass with radius, suppose capital R, if that r is a function of t.
The mass with maybe you're talking about small m. You're talking about small m. You're talking about the mass inside. If that is varying, you see the mass inside actually can't vary while keeping everything outside being the vacuum, because mass is conserved. So, you know, you can't have a solution where, you know, the mass inside is varying with some t, but everything outside is the vacuum. Now you can't, if you take a ball about a given spot and everything outside is the vacuum, the mass inside that can't vary with time, because mass is conserved. So there's no setup in which, you know, the mass inside is varying with time, because there's nowhere for the mass to go. The mass can come out of the ball, but then things outside are not the vacuum. And so it can't be that the mass inside is varying in some sense while keeping things being. That was your question. Right? What happens if m varies as a function of t? So m can't vary as a function of t if everything outside is a vacuum. Okay, there's no sense in which that can happen.
So
we can look at more general solutions, like the Riesen-Ostroff solution. This is, you know, the statement that I've written it here is that this is the unique spherically symmetric vacuum solution. Yes, yeah. So of course, there are, you know, if you add matter, then you can have more general solutions, but this is the unique spherically symmetric vacuum. So this is, and it's a rather powerful theorem, and it actually tells you something rather interesting. You know, it tells you that if you just have spherical symmetry, then you can't even have gravitational radiation in that setup. You know, you might have thought that you take some star, you take some sphere, and you make the sphere pulse. Okay? So the sphere grows and shrinks and it's doing something. So the mass is staying constant, but the sphere is pulsing, and you might have thought that some system of that kind would emit gravitational radiation. Now these are things that could happen. You could imagine a star which, you know, is undergoing some oscillations or something like that, and you might have thought that something like this would emit gravitational radiation, but this Birkhoff's theorem is telling us that it can't. You know, because we didn't start out by assuming that things were static. We found that things were static, that nothing depends on time. We started out by just assuming spherical symmetry. So if there's some star which is doing whatever crazy thing that it wants inside, you know, which is pulsing, where the internal dynamics is doing something very complicated, but as long as it's always maintaining spherical symmetry, the outside solution is fixed to the Schwarzschild solution. And this is something that's rather remarkable that happens with spherical symmetry, that doesn't happen the moment you give up spherical symmetry. So there are some other theorems which we'll talk about what happens if you give up spherical symmetry, but all of those theorems have to do with what happens, you know, when things settle down. Or this is something that doesn't require things to settle down, it just needs spherical symmetry to be preserved. Okay, so this is one important result which I'd like all of you to keep in mind. Okay, good. So now we have this solution, and now we want to analyze some of the physics of this solution. Yeah.
We have identified m as the mass of
yes.
the body. So t is the real time in which we measure, right?
I want to talk about that next, but yeah, go on.
In our all coordinates, r is the function of t naught and r naught, right?
Of t naught and whatever the original t naught was?
Yes,
yeah.
R naught and t naught. R is the function of t naught and r naught. So I'm identifying m as the mass. So, I mean, in the same way, I'm identifying t as the time.
I'm going to say immediately now something about what you identify as the time.
Okay.
But go on, what's your question? You can ask me. But ask your question and then
I mean, what is t here?
What is t here?
Yeah.
Okay, good. So then wait to do.
Okay.
Okay, so what is t here? That's a good question. So the next thing I want to talk about is precisely this. You know, what?
One question. Birkhoff's theorem says that there is a unique spherical symmetry Jacobian solution.
Correct.
So it sounds much like a uniqueness theorem we get in. Quartoisian equation or something like that. Because there are also, if you specify the solution on the boundary, right? So is there any connection?
I mean, I don't know what you're referring to precisely, but so the interesting thing that Birkhoff's theorem is saying is that, you know, if you want to look at the field outside, it's totally determined by spherical symmetry, even if there are oscillations or various other things that are happening in the radial direction. So even if you have, as I said, even if you have some star that's pulsing, so even then the solution outside is given by something very simple, which only knows about the total mass inside. So the physical content of Birkhoff's theorem is that, and that is somewhat unusual. You know, you might have thought that, you know, that you might have thought that in general something that's pulsing might send out radiation in S-space, but it doesn't. So the physical content of Birkhoff's theorem is that. There may be other systems, I don't know what you're referring to precisely. So there could be, you know, there could be other situations where you might have similar uniqueness theorems.
I think
but yeah.
To that point, that the mass, when you're looking at the geodesic equation, the mass really fixes certain parameters on the side of the surface.
But the fact that the mass fixes certain parameters is not relevant. What's relevant for us is that we fix the whole metric using only spherical symmetry in the vacuum solution. So we fix, you know, that it's not, there are no, someone said, you know, what if you make m vary as a function of t, you know, what if you have some other crazy thing happening inside? And the thing is, you can't have any other crazy thing happening inside. You know, that's the thing is, you know, in the end, this solution, the fact that the solution has this form, we got by solving the equation, the fact that m was related to the mass is a physical interpretation of the parameters of the solution. And the interesting physical content is that, you know, if you have spherical symmetry, then you've fixed the whole You can't do anything with it. There's no interesting dynamics outside if you're saying. That's right. Okay. Good. So now I want to talk about this issue of, you know, what it means, you know, what time is. Actually, how am I doing for time? What's time now? Okay, good. So that's good. So next half we want to discuss properties of this guy. Okay, so to discuss this, you know, imagine two observers who are sitting at fixed values of r. Okay. So you have one observer who is sitting at one value of r1. There's another observer who is sitting at r2. So this, you, can imagine as an RT diagram. Okay, so this is E. This is R. Okay. Now this observer who's sitting at this fixed value of R, he sends a light ray. The light ray doesn't quite move at 45 degrees, but it moves in some trajectory. So he sends some light ray here. So he sends a light ray at E0. He's sending signals. Okay, so the person at R1 is sending signals to the person at R2. And he sends some light ray here. And then after the time delta t, he sends another light ray. So this time, delta t. This is received here at E1, and the first thing is, you know, what is the difference in terms of coordinate time for this guided receiving? So if this is T0 and this is T0 plus delta t, there's some relation for what T1 is as a function of R1 and R2, okay, which we can compute. But you know how much this distance is? You know, when does the next light ray reach? This reaches the T1 plus. So this interval is delta t. You know what this interval is? Yeah, this interval is also delta t. The reason this interval is delta t is because, you know, light rays move along geodesics. So how do light rays move? You see, light rays move basically in a way so as to keep, you know, 1 minus twice m by r. Now they move because so as to keep dx squared equal to 0 along the light ray. Okay? So there's some fixed relation which tells you, you know, how what dt by dr is. Okay? And the key point is that dt by dr doesn't depend on t. So when I send this at t0 or when I send this at t0 plus delta t, the time it takes for it to go from r1 to r2, you know, doesn't change from t0 to this t0 plus delta t. Okay? So that means that this time, if this time is delta t, then this time is also delta t in terms of coordinate time. So it tells you, and that comes from this equation. It comes from the fact that if you look at this equation, which is a geodesic equation, there's some formula for dr by dt. It tells you that dr by dt is 1 minus twice n by r. Dt by dr is, you know, the inverse of that. But that doesn't change on t. That doesn't depend on t. It depends on r, but it doesn't depend on t. So this time, you know, the difference t0 minus t1, it's some function of R1 and R2, which depends on what R1 and R2 are. But this delta t is not a function of anything. It's just, you know, this delta t is just carried over there. Okay. But that doesn't tell you, you know, that's actually not something very physical, because if someone asked, you know, what does this coordinate time after all mean? What does it mean to have this coordinate time? So in fact, you have to think of some observer, and you have to think of what is the time that this person is measuring. What's the time that the observer at R1 and what's the time that the observer at R2 is measuring? So if you have some observer at R1, you see that he would like to describe, you know, the world about him locally, you know, as something which is flat. You know, so let's say you have some observer who's just sitting at some constant value of R. This observer who's sitting at a constant value of R has a clock, and what this clock is going to measure is going to be this observer's proper time. This clock is not going to measure this dt. So if you have an observer who's just sitting at r equal to constant and at omega equal to constant, the clock is going to tell him, you know, how ds changes. It's not going to tell him how dt changes, right? So that means that the clock that the observer at R1 is going to use is actually going to give him a different reading. It's going to tell him that the true time interval as measured by this observer, the time interval between these two signals, is not this delta t, but is something else. That's it. R1 and R2 right now are greater than 2m. So far, very good. So far everything is greater than 2m. I'm going to talk about what happens as you approach 2m in a second. But so far everything is greater than 2m. Okay? So this proper time measured by the observer 1 is actually this. Okay? And the proper time as measured by the observer 2 is this. And this proper time is the physical time as measured by these observers, and that's different from the coordinate time as measured by these observers. These guys don't have any significance for delta t. What they have significance for is their proper time, which is related to, and the intervals of proper time are related in this way to the intervals of coordinate time. Okay? So in particular, the intervals of proper time are different for these two guys. So if one person is sending, has a clock which tells him, instructs him to send a light ray after every 1 second, the other person doesn't receive things at the interval of 1 second. In fact, there's a ratio which is, it tells you that one and related to that there's a frequency. Now it tells you the frequency in formula as seen by these two observers. So this relation between the frequencies is what's called the gravitational redshift. You see, if you imagine that R1 is smaller than R2, okay, so R1 is closer to 2m than R2, R2 is larger, then you see that omega 1 will be larger than omega 2. Okay? That's, if R1 is smaller than R2, then, you can check that this number is larger than this number, and therefore omega 1 is smaller than omega 2. Okay? So if you have an observer who's sending frequencies, who's sending light rays which are blue, by the time they reach this person, they'll be shifted to being slightly redder. Okay? And this relation is what's called the gravitational redshift. And it's a very important prediction of the Schwarzschild solution, that there is this gravitational redshift. You can think of this gravitational redshift in another way. You can think of this gravitational redshift as the energy lost by the photon as it has to climb out of the gravitational potential. As the photon is going from smaller values of r to larger values of r, that's like on our Earth, going from a smaller value of r from the surface to the roof or to some other higher height. And you can see that as you do this, you gain some potential energy, and therefore the photon has to lose some of its energy in terms of frequency, and it gets redshifted. In fact, this gravitational redshift is something that's measurable. It was measured in a famous experiment by Pound and Rebka. And in fact, they didn't even need too much to measure. They took, in fact, the physics department at Harvard, which has, fourth floor and the ground floor is not a very tall building. And they sent light rays from the basement of the physics department and collected it on top, and they were able to observe this gravitational. So this gravitational redshift is something that's statically observable, and it's something that's an important prediction of the Schwarzschild solution. And it tells you, precisely this: if you have some observer, who's sending signals from some point in the interior, by the time they reach out to infinity, these photons lose some energy. So there's a question in the for the tutorial, which is the following. So let's say we have two people. One lives. So the Earth is the only thing in the universe. We don't care about the sun or anything else. We have two people. One lives here. See that? One person lives on top of the mountain. So now, these two people were born at the same time, and then one person went to the top of the mountain, the other person stayed at the bottom. When this person becomes 70 years old, how old is this person? So it's a question which you should try and solve by 5 o'clock. So is the question clear? The two people, one, they're born at the same time, then one is immediately transported to the top of the mountain, and they spend the rest of their lives there. So by the time this person becomes 70 years old, how old is he?
So here, I can think of delta tau 1 is a person is sitting at a R1 distance and has a watch and is measuring the time.
Right? Correct.
So, and result is like that delta tau 1 delta tau doesn't depend on the t.
Correct.
Right. So it means I find it out today or set some later time, it will be the same.
Correct.
Right. But I find out delta tau 1 by delta tau 1 using that metric which we have derived. If I take another metric in terms of R0 and T node, then I will get delta tau 1 divided delta tau 2 as a function of T. I know it, right?
I mean,
and
you know,
in that case, my this time difference between the signals will not be.
There's some physical significance to these coordinates. The physical significance is that, you know, these are the coordinates in which things are now looking static. You could use some different coordinate system, but then you would have to, you know, you'd have, if you ask the same physical question, you'll get the same physical answer. The physical question that one is asking here is, imagine two observers who are sitting at fixed values of R. Okay, so in fact, one is specifying their entire world line of these two observers. So there's a totally physical process, which is totally coordinate independent, which I just erased actually, which is that you have two observers who have some world line, and the observer here is sending signals with some difference in proper time. And the question is, you know, these light rays, when do they reach here? This is a totally coordinate independent question. This is not a question that depends on coordinate system. This coordinate system makes it easy to analyze this, because this coordinate system tells you that something is fixed, which is the coordinate time delta t, and you can write delta tau 1 in terms of that and delta tau 2 in terms of that, and that helps you determine the relationship between delta tau 1 and delta tau 2. But you're free to use a different coordinate system. The relationship between delta tau 1 and delta tau 2 will not change, provided you make sure that these two observers are in the same world line. This is not, you know, this relationship of delta tau 1 and delta t is a coordinate dependent relationship, because you put in a choice of coordinate here. This relationship is not a coordinate dependent relationship. It's a relationship between proper times as measured by observers and a particular world line. I mean, what's coordinate dependent here is the specification of the world line, that they're saying at what's called constant r. But, you know, otherwise, after that's done, this is something which is, you know, a ratio between two proper times. So that's, you know, that's totally independent of what coordinate system. So you can verify, if you like, by taking a different coordinate system, you'll get the same answer.
You should just be careful about using this coordinate system only where it is valid.
Oh, yes. So I'll come to where it's valid in a second. Okay, good. So, very good. Okay, good. So good. I'm glad all of you are anticipating what I'm about to say. So let's talk about where the coordinate system is valid. So first, if you look at this formula, you'll start seeing something rather funny, which is, you know, imagine the situation where R1 becomes close to 2m. Okay? So R1 starts going towards 2m. By the way, this m is, you should check what this m is. This m in these units is actually something which has dimensions of length. And you can check what m is for the sun and for other things. So, you know, for the sun or for the earth and so on. And for doing these problems, you'd actually have to determine what m is after you reinsert factors of the speed of light for the sun and for the earth and so on. But m is something which has dimensions of length. Okay, for the earth, it's about 1 centimeter. For the sun, it's about 3 kilometers. You can check that. But for the earth, it's about 1 centimeter. So now you can ask, you know, what happens if you have some observer who starts approaching 2m? Now, there are two things. For a long time, people didn't actually think about this. The Schwarzschild solution was known for a long time. It was known from 1919. And people didn't ask these questions about what would happen if you approach 2m. Because you can see that physically, it sounds very unreasonable. It's a question of what would happen if you started approaching, you know, the Earth at a distance of 1 centimeter. But usually, what would happen is that all the mass of the Earth wouldn't be concentrated within that 1 centimeter. So really, if you want to use this solution and start asking questions of what happens as you start approaching r equal to 2m, you need to basically first concentrate all of this mass within a size of 2m. Okay? And as you can see, that physically that involves, you know, in terms of everyday objects, that involves densities that are extremely high. So for the Earth, if I wanted to use this solution all the way down to 2m, remember it's a vacuum solution, so I'd have to create a situation where all the mass of the Earth was concentrated in a region which was just for size, you know, which is just 1 centimeter across. So I'd have to really compactify the Earth a great amount and then consider, you know, what happens to the solution. And for this reason, people actually didn't take this solution seriously, or didn't take this, you know, this somewhat singular point in the solution seriously for a long time. Much later, you know, till the 50s and so on, when Wheeler and others began to discuss these black holes, or you know, maybe not the 50s, but at least, you know, initially when Schwarzschild came up with the solution, this wasn't something that was taken too seriously. But now we know that, you know, these black holes exist, and so we should take these solutions seriously. And we are in fact going to discuss, you know, precisely what happens when you go to r equal to 2m and beyond. Okay, so the first thing to notice is that as you start, you know, imagine that we have somehow done, you use some process to compactify the Earth to a size of 1 centimeter, or somehow compactify the Sun to within 3 kilometers. If you do that, you start noticing something rather funny. You start noticing that this 2m, you know, this term, okay, goes off to 0. So let's say R1 starts approaching 2m, this term goes off to 0, and then you will see that, you know, whatever you take omega 1 to be, the omega 2 effectively becomes 0. So therefore, this, you know, the redshift starts approaching infinity. So the observer who is very close to the black hole horizon and trying to sit at constant R, you know, whatever he sends, whatever signals he sends out, get redshifted enormously. And for some observer who is sitting outside, you know, it looks like this observer who is approaching the black hole horizon is getting frozen at the horizon because time looks like it's stopping, you know, for the observer who is approaching the horizon. And therefore, there is this very large redshift between inside and outside as you approach m is equal to 2r. So that might actually lead you to think that there is something bad happening at 2m is equal to r. You might think that something bad is happening at r equal to 2m. But in fact, there is no singularity at r equal to 2m. And I claim that the reason the metric is looking singular is because you are using a bad coordinate system. Okay? And also the reason you are getting this infinite redshift is actually because you're asking a bad question here. Okay? So let me try and tell you why it is that you're asking a bad question when you see this infinite redshift, and why it is that this coordinate system is bad. The reason you're asking a bad question here is because you can try and ask, so this is a question of what is the redshift between two observers who are sitting at constant r. Okay? Now these two observers who are sitting at constant r are actually doing something somewhat singular. You know, this observer who's trying to float outside the horizon at something of constant r is actually accelerating, you know, very, very rapidly. You can check that this person is actually accelerating, and he's accelerating because, you know, he's actually in some gravitational field. So this person is actually accelerating, and if you ask the question of what happens to someone who is an infalling observer, who is just following some geodesic, then you can check that this person, you know, reaches in this coordinate system r equal to 2m and can in fact fall smoothly through, and you can see the fact that you can fall smoothly through, and then, you know, this singularity is only a coordinate singularity by explicitly making a change of coordinates. Okay? So this change of coordinates, there are many coordinates that do this, but the claim. So actually let me first demonstrate the claim and then I'll give you justification. The claim is that this singularity what's happening is that the coordinate system is becoming slightly singular. There's nothing physical that's happening at r equal. There's nothing that's physically bad that's happening at r equal to 2m. The easiest way to demonstrate that is to show you that nothing physical is happening. So I'm going to make a change of coordinate system that shows that this region is actually smooth. The change of coordinate systems are, in fact, one of these GR centennial papers that I mentioned is a paper by Kruskal. So you should look up this paper by Kruskal. It's a very short paper. It's only one page. Now, which says explicitly shows this coordinate change that makes the metric non-singular at this point, and it's really it's shorter than what I'll do now. So it's a nice paper to read. Okay. So you know the first step to showing that the coordinates are non-singular is to define what I call the tortoise coordinates. Okay. So I'm going to define something called the tortoise coordinate, which has the property that the metric looks like. I'm defining this coordinate r star is a coordinate which is a function of r. Okay. So alternately, r is a function of r star, so it's a coordinate change. But I want to write the metric in a way so it has this form dt square is equal to dr square. The advantage of writing the metric in this form is that light rays follow something rather simple. They basically fall along, you know, constant t plus r star or constant t minus r star. Yes, so writing the metric in this form makes the structure of light rays very simple, and will also make these things very simple. This is r of r star. So this is all r. R is always a function of r. So let me not even write r of r. So I've changed coordinates to r star. There's an inverse transformation to r. R is now a function of r star. Whenever I write r now, I'm meaning r as a function of r star. Yeah, but the metric is written in terms of r star. Okay. So what is r star, by the way? You know, to see what r star is, it's clear that what you need is that 1 minus twice m by r E R squared. Tells you that this 2m in the denominator I fix. Just an integration constant, the rest of it is fixed. Okay. So you can see that if you make this transformation where r star is r plus this, the metric will take this form. Okay, there's an inverse transformation which tells you r is a function of r star, and that will be some inverse function of r star, and that's what enters in these coordinates. Okay, good. So now you can see that as r goes to 2m, okay, as r starts going to 2m, r star starts going off to minus infinity. Okay. As r goes to 2m, r star starts going off to minus infinity. But it's useful to define some new coordinates, what are called Kruskal coordinates, which are defined, and there are some conventions here. Alpha is a constant which I'm going to fix in a second. Okay, this is just, I'm defining some new coordinates, which are these u and v coordinates. Okay, now notice that if you look at du, so as you can see, obviously a lot of what I'm doing here is done by hindsight, but I just want to show you the result and then we can justify why it came about. Now, if you look at du dv, you find that you just pull down some factors of r star. Okay. So du dv is something that's manifestly non-singular. It's something that's almost like the flat space metric. And you can check just from that coordinate transformation that you get some factors of alpha squared. And apart from that, it looks a lot like this dt squared minus dr squared term that we demanded there. Okay? So it looks a lot like that. Except there's this e to the alpha r star, whereas there we have this 1 minus 2m by r, which was the term that was becoming singular as r goes to 2m. And the question is if we can use these two terms if you can play out these two terms. And in fact, you can check that you can. And if you look near the singularity, if you take that form that I had for r star, you can check that, near this horizon, 2m, you can check that e to the twice alpha r star, or e to the twice alpha r h, which is, comes from the leading term, okay, into r minus 2m by 2m. The 4 comes because there was a 2m outside, and I multiplied to 2 alpha, so I got a 4m alpha. Okay. And therefore you can see that if you set 4m alpha equal to 1, okay, then you will get once again this 1 minus twice m by r factor that you had there. Okay. So in fact, the claim is, and you can check, that if you set 4m alpha equal to 1, if you make this coordinate choice and you set 4m alpha equal to 1, then that metric, which looks singular, you know, starts becoming something, looks much nicer. Instead of this metric, which is something which looks like it has something bad happening near 2m by r, you get a metric which looks like minus eu ev into some constants which are not important, but whatever, here they are. And now R is a function of U and V. Okay, it's a function of U and V that's obtained by doing the inverse transformations of whatever transformations we did. So it's some complicated and horribly complicated function of U and V. But whatever it is, it's some well-defined function of U and V. And this is the coordinate. And you can see that this coordinate is clearly a totally non-singular as R goes to 2m. So this coordinate is totally fine as R goes to 2m. And that's because this singularity that we had here was basically a coordinate singularity. So this is an explicit demonstration of the fact that you can change to a coordinate basis where things look completely regular at r equal to 2n and there's no singularity. In fact, this du dv is like the metric of flat space. You know, I could write, by making a linear transformation of flat space, I can write the metric of flat space as du dv. Okay, so this is a metric which looks a lot like flat space. Near r equal to 2n, and the original singularity we were saying was because we are using a bad coordinate system. Okay, are there any questions at this point?
So that is 32 n small n cube?
32, oh good, it's 32 small n cube. Okay. So I should say the 32. I think the 32 factor is right, but I'm going to check it. The 32 factor is very unimportant, but let me check it. I have it down in my notes, and I hope there's not a 2 factor.
I think that's what the definition of u is equal to minus particular factor there of 4m.
A what?
You need a factor of 4m and the definition of u and v, then you'll get the 32.
Is it? I need a factor of 4m. Sorry. I can check. Forget about this constant. I'll check this constant later. It may be that I need a factor of this thing in the definition of the constant. I'll tell you what the constant is. Okay. But the constant is not important. What's important is this. It's that there's this e to the minus r by 2 m, and everything looks not singular. Okay. So now, now using these u and v coordinates, you can actually get some global picture of what the spacetime is. And the global picture of the spacetime now you get is as follows. So now it's useful to draw the spacetime in terms of these u and v coordinates, then the r and t coordinates. And then you see that what you get is some spacetime that basically goes from u equal to minus infinity to v equals plus infinity. To u equals plus infinity, except that there are some true singularities in the solution, and to see where those true singularities are, it's useful to check in one more way that the singularity at r equal to 2m, which we thought was there, actually is not there. And one more way to see that is to check the behavior of curvature invariance. I showed you by doing some explicit coordinate transformation that things were smooth near r equals 2n. But now I want to check in one more way by computing some curvature invariance to show you that actually curvature invariance are also small near this point r equals 2n. So one useful curvature invariance that's often useful to calculate is just the trace of the Ricci tensor. Do you know what that is here near the horizon? Good, very good. So it's zero. It's zero because we are in the vacuum solution, and therefore this is zero. But there are other things that are not zero. So one thing that's not zero is this. Okay. It's the square of the Riemann tensor. So you can take the square of the Riemann tensor, and you take the Riemann tensor and you can square it. If any of the components of the Riemann tensor is becoming very large, this is something that will tell you that some of the components of the Riemann tensor are becoming large. So this is one invariant way of saying that curvatures are becoming large in some region or not. So this is, you know, one invariant that tells you what is happening. You can compute what this invariant is. Turns out to be 48 m squared by r to the 6. Okay. So in particular, as you are at r equals 2m, this square this goes down like 1 by m to the 4. Okay. And this is the second important result that I want to emphasize today, which is that if you look at the region your r equals 2m, not only does the region not have a singularity, in fact curvature invariants are very small for larger black holes. Now if you take a black hole with a large mass and you look at this region r equals 2m near that black hole, near that very big black hole, these curvature invariants are extremely small. In fact, they go down the larger the black hole that you have. Okay? So sometimes, you know, there might be these science fiction stories. I'll tell you, there's this huge black hole which had a tremendous gravitational field. But in fact, huge black holes do not have tremendous gravitational fields near the horizon. Okay, so if you look at huge black holes and you're outside the horizon, in fact, the gravitational field near a huge black hole or near this, you know, these huge black holes at the center of our galaxy is small. Now that region looks a lot like you're in flat space. Okay? So it could be that there's some very, very, very big black hole that's coming right now to swallow us up, and we wouldn't even know about that, you know, because we would be in a region, as long as we are far away from the black hole, and as long as the outside this region r equal to 2m, these curvature invariants are very small. So this is the second important point that I want to emphasize today, which is that the region r equal to 2m is not only non-singular, the region r equals 2m is in fact very smooth. Okay, so this is the second important point. Are there any questions about this?
Before interpreting, shouldn't we understand what r square is?
Shouldn't we understand what r square is? Good. So one way, r square, r square tells you any of the components of r are becoming large. Now what does the Riemann tensor tell you? The Riemann tensor is one invariant measure of how curvatures are. One thing you could do to check, which actually I was thinking of doing, but I didn't do. Is you can take two nearby geodesics, and there's a geodesic deviation equation that tells you how two nearby geodesics deviate, which is how, you know, someone would measure whether they were in flat space or not. What enters into a geodesic equation is the Riemann tensor. Okay? So two nearby geodesics deviate by a lot if some components of the Riemann tensor are large. So r square, if r square is small, it tells you, you know, some sum of positive terms. So if r square is small, it tells you that none of the components of the Riemann tensor are large. If none of the components of the Riemann tensor are large, then it tells you that geodesics don't deviate, and any measure of curvature that you write down is correct. Is that good? Any other questions about this? This solution is this thing I wrote is exact.
Yeah,
the statement that.
Can
you see what?
Okay, so far.
The statement that it's near large black holes, things look a lot like flat space. That's true for large black holes. Of course, larger the black hole, the flatter it is.
Geodesic deviation
is the tidal force. Correct. That is less than large. That's right. You know, geodesic deviation is how in the end you determine, you know, whether you're in flat space. Okay, good. So now, you know, you can use this. But by the way, this computation also tells you that something bad is happening at some point, and the place where something bad is happening is r equal to 0. Okay, and this is a true singularity. Okay? So the place r equal to 0 is a true singularity. Okay, but the place r equal to 2m is not a singularity. Okay. So now I'm going to draw for you, you know, a picture of the full geometry. That is one of the last things I want to do. And the picture of the full geometry now goes as follows. You can draw these U and V curves. You can check that the horizon that was r equal to 2m, if you go back to the tortoise coordinate, becomes the line u is equal to 0. This is the line u is equal to 0. So v varies along the line. the reason I'm drawing the line u equal to 0 and 45 degrees is because u equal to 0 is the direction of a null ray. So remember that this coordinate looks like du dv. Okay? If I'm sitting at u equal to constant and I've forgotten about any motion on this S2, then I'm basically on a null ray. So u equal to constant or v equal to constant are the trajectories of null rays, and therefore I'm using the usual convention of space-time diagrams, which is to draw null rays at 45 degrees. And so here's a null ray at 45 degrees, which is u equal to 0. And this was the point that we were calling r equal to 2n. Okay? Now, this is Debye's horizons. Of course, if there's a u equal to v 0 line, there's also a v equal to 0 line. Okay? I'll mention what this v equal to 0 and these other parts are. But for now, this u equal to 0 is what we were calling the... this is what I'm going to call the horizon. And I'll tell you in a second why I call it the horizon. Now the question is, what happened to our original coordinates, u and v? Our original coordinates r and t. And you can check from the transformations that we did that lines of constant t are lines of this kind. So t equals constant implies v by u equals constant. Okay. So lines of constant, maybe I'll use red. Lines of constant t are lines of this kind. Okay, they are lines that pass through these origins, these uv coordinates. They are lines that do this. Okay. Now what about lines of constant r in these uv planes? You know what lines of constant r are? Yes. Lines of constant r are hyperboloids. Because you see that r equals constant plus uv equals constant. And that's a hyperbola. So lines of constant r are hyperboloid. You can see that this line, which is this, is also an extreme hyperboloid. You know, it's some limit of the hyperboloid. The line, which was the line we were calling the horizon. So these are constant r, constant e. You can check that this line, which is r equal to 0, is something that's sitting here, which is uv equal to 1. Okay, so that... this is the singularity, which is that r equals 0. So this is the singularity, it's really a singularity. This part was just, it's some u equal to 0 line, it's not special. But, this u equal to 0 line is not locally special. So locally, for some observer who crosses it, this line, which is u equal to 0, which is what we are calling the horizon, looks a lot like any other space in the diagram. However, there is something that is special about it, which is that the horizon, separates this space into two parts. Once an observer, crosses into the horizon, there's no way for this observer to reach back out to spatial infinity. You can see that this observer has to necessarily fall into the singularity, because all these geodesics, once you're inside the horizon, terminate on the singularity. But, if you're outside, you can just continue to stay outside. You can just continue to stay on some r equal to 0 line till the end of your life and never hit the singularity. But once you're behind this u equal to 0 line, you're forced to hit the singularity. The interpretation of these two regions is clear. This is the region outside the black hole. It's the region r is greater than 2m. This is the region inside the black hole. Okay. Now what about these two regions? These two regions are things that in some sense, once you try to extend the coordinate system the way we did, they are things that come for free. This is like a white hole. Okay. This region in the past. And sometimes called region 4. The 1, 2, 3, 4 is a matter of convention. But this region in the past is like a white hole, and this is a white hole horizon. So it looks like things are popping out of here. The world comes into existence from this white hole, and then things fall back into the black hole. So this region in the past is a white hole, and then we have another region which is asymptotically flat, which is some other region, 3 region. And these are things that come for free. And this diagram is called a Kruskal diagram. And it's what's called the maximal extension of the Schwarzschild solution. Okay? So just to recap, what we did is we started with the Schwarzschild solution. We had some coordinates. That describes the solution in this patch, which is what is called region 1. Then we looked at this point and we said, oh, you know, this, it looks like the coordinates are going bad, but we can extend the coordinates. And when we extend the coordinates, we get not only this region in the forward region, we get all of these other regions for free as well. In fact, in these, all of these regions, you can introduce another set of Schwarzschild coordinates. So in fact, even though the Schwarzschild coordinates become bad at the horizon, you can introduce another set of Schwarzschild coordinates basically just by changing the signs of the relative definitions. So, you know, in, for example, in this is the region in our conventions which had u smaller than 0, v smaller than 0, or v larger than 0. This has u greater than 0, v greater than 0. This has u greater than 0, v smaller than 0. And this has u smaller than 0, v smaller than 0. Okay? So these four quadrants are just labeled by whether u and v are positive or not. And in fact, in each of these coordinates, you can introduce a Schwarzschild solution. Which, for example, in, you know, all you have to do is basically write, you have to put in some minus signs. For example, in, let me tell you, in region 2, and so on. You know, you just use the appropriate sign. As long as you insert the appropriate minus signs in these places, you can introduce some other coordinate systems here, and you find that this line, this line is the line t equals in these coordinate systems. This line, which is the horizon, is not only the line, r equals 2l, but it's also the line which is, r star equals minus infinity and t equals plus infinity. Can you read this at the back? So this line in front is the line r star equals minus infinity, t equals plus infinity. So r star minus t, something that goes off to minus infinity, and therefore u goes off to 0. But along this line, r star plus t in some sense stays finite, and that's what tells you different v values. Okay. This is the line t equals plus infinity. Okay, this is r star equals minus infinity, and t equals minus infinity. And so that's this line. And this line, inside is still r star equals minus infinity. So this line is a line r star equals minus infinity, t equals infinity. This line is a line r star equals minus infinity and t equals minus infinity. Okay? And the reason for these signs, t equals plus infinity and minus infinity, is actually somewhat intuitive. It comes from the previous discussion we had about redshift. Okay? And the reason for that is that if you imagine, some observer who's going through, you imagine some observer who's, run out of colors of chalk. Imagine some observer who starts his life somewhere here, and falls through the horizon, and enters ends his life with a singularity. You can check, and tomorrow we will check, that the proper time taken for the observer to fall through is finite. But in terms of an observer at infinity, what this observer at infinity sees is that this guy just gets frozen here. And that's because the last light ray that he can emit is a light ray that he emits from here, which is a light ray along the horizon. Any light rays that this observer, white observer, emits from here, fall into the singularity and never reach the observer out at infinity, who may be somewhere here. I'm running out of space in the diagram, but here's my observer outside. Okay? So here's my observer outside, and the last light ray that this person can send that will reach this observer outside is a light ray that's just before he crosses the horizon. And once he crosses the horizon, he can't send any more light rays. And therefore, this person thinks that this guy reached the horizon basically at t equals infinity. And that's the intuitive reason that this is the line, t equals infinity. But there's some value of the tortoise coordinate, and the way you remember that is by checking that, either the sum or the difference of these things remains constant along this line. Okay? So this is a picture of the global structure of the Schwarzschild solution. Tomorrow I'm going to show you a more realistic solution. This is, the solution that we formed was a solution that was a solution of the vacuum Einstein equations everywhere. Now you know that, things are not the vacuum everywhere, otherwise this mass, where did it come from? So when you look at a collapsing shell of matter, when you really look at collapsing stars, they don't actually have these, all of these regions. what they have is roughly half of the Schwarzschild solution. They have some matter which started from smooth initial data and formed the singularity. So the fact that you have this singularity in this horizon is something that we believe is true in realistic collapse. The fact that you have these other extended regions is some kind of mathematical artifact and is not really, you know, the case for real collapsing black holes. Don't actually generate these things, generate these other regions. But you know, they're interesting as maximal extensions, but they're not really physical. But anyway, you know, since we did this coordinate transformation, I wanted to show you all these. Okay, so I'm almost done. I'm probably almost done with time as well. In fact, maybe I can talk about the Penrose diagrams tomorrow. Okay, so there's one more way to picturize the causal structure of these things, which is in terms of what's called a Penrose diagram, which I'll mention. But it basically captures the same information as this, but by, you know, in some finite space rather than taking things off to infinity. So there's another useful tool to capture basically this information that we captured here, which was information about the causal structure, which is called Penrose diagrams. But since I'm out of time, I'll stop here and do that tomorrow. Maybe before I stop though, if there are any questions about what I said. So let me just recap roughly what I said and what are the important points that I'd like you to remember. So the first thing is that, you know, we started off by looking for spherically symmetric solutions to Einstein's equations. And we found that there was a unique spherically symmetric vacuum solution, which was the Schwarzschild solution. And this is a powerful result because it tells us, you know, that whatever is happening inside, even if things are varying with time, as long as they're spherically symmetric, things outside look the same. And that's a rather unusual feature of this theory of gravity. And that, and this is called Birkhoff's theorem, and there's this unique solution which we can find, starting with rather weak results. This unique solution happens to have some funny properties. One of the funny properties it has is the property of gravitational redshift, okay, which is that people who are sitting closer to the central mass, you know, if they send a signal, it takes, you know, energy for the photons to propagate outwards, and therefore photons tend to get redshifted as they go out, and we can compute from this solution quantitatively what this gravitational redshift is. It looks like the solution has another funny property, which is that there is a special coordinate point, which is where you know, the solution looks like it is becoming singular, and where the gravitational redshift goes off to infinity. But the other important thing we did was we showed that by means of coordinate transformations of this kind, you can actually, you know, show that this point r equals 2n, which looks like it's singular, is actually not singular. In fact, not only is it not singular, you can compute curvature invariance, and you find that these curvature invariants are very small near the horizon. So not only is it not singular, it's in fact this region for a very big black hole is very close to being flat space. The bigger the black hole, the closer this is to being flat space. But there is something special about this when you look at the global causal structure of the solution that you get. So this point r equals 2m is not special in any local way, but it is special in a global way, and that global causal structure is brought out by this thing called the Kruskal diagram, and equivalently by something called the Penrose diagram. And it tells you that when you look at the global structure of the solution, it gets divided into four quadrants. It has a future, this is sometimes called a future horizon, and a past horizon, a black hole, and a white hole, a black hole singularity and a white hole singularity. And, you know, but nevertheless, as we'll see tomorrow, you know, not all parts, this solution and this global structure are capturing some important parts of realistic stellar collapse into black hole, in particular the existence of the event horizon and the existence of a singularity, but they're also giving us some mathematical artifacts, which is the existence of these, you know, other universes, which perhaps don't exist in their realistic stellar collapse. Okay, so these are the important points which I wanted to make today, and if there are any questions, I can take them now. We can also discuss them.
What is the maximal extension?
Maximal extension is what I said. You know, it's a situation where we've made sure that, you know, geodesics are only terminating on singularities. So we've extended, you know, we've basically, colloquially speaking, you've extended the coordinate system as much as is possible.
How do you know when a space-time has been maximally extended?
But you can compute all geodesics here, and you can see that the Penrose diagram is one way to see it. You can look at all geodesics here, and you can see that geodesics either terminate on this curvature singularity or they go off it.